2012 election deaths pose risk for polls. Gamato vows to stamp out election fraud. And Morobe provincial government presents 2017 budget in Waigani.
This is National EMTV News with Helen Sayer.
Good evening and thank you for joining me for Wednesday's news. Before we give you tonight's headlines, aviation authorities in PNG are yet to confirm an attempted hijacking by a passenger on an Air Niugini flight on Monday. The suspect, whose identity remains unknown, allegedly inflated a life jacket before reaching for his bag and trying to exit through the emergency door. An eyewitness on the flight told EMTV News the suspect was subdued by two other passengers. The incident happened over Indonesian airspace on the Singapore-bound flight. More details of the attempted hijacking are expected to be revealed tomorrow in a news conference. As the 2017 general elections approach, outstanding bills from the 2012 elections are posing some risk. The Electoral Commissioner, Patilias Gamato, today urged the government to settle these bills prior to the start of the election period to avoid any unnecessary setbacks.
Commissioner Gamato was speaking on radio this morning on the progress of election preparations. The amount of outstanding bills from the last election totaled to 36 million kina.
We still have outstanding claims. We still have outstanding claims basically categorized into two parts, the legal claims and the general service providers. General service providers claims about 17 million, and the legal claims was 42 million kina. But we got the Department of Justice, Attorney General, to vet the claims, and they vetted the claims and brought it down to about 19 million kina.
This, he hopes, the government, through the Interdepartment Election Committee, can be able to settle soon.
I see that as a risk because if we don't settle the bills and go out there, they might not provide the service. They might not give us the service. I was given very specific instruction. The budget for this year is for the election. So I cannot use the budget for this year to sort outstanding claims. So the onus is now on the government to pay the outstanding bills.
Apart from that, logistics and procurement plan for the elections are progressing well, especially for ballot boxes and inks, with specific requirements for the different regions in the country.
Yeah, basically we'll use those two, the plastic box and the metal boxes. Metal boxes mostly in the islands. We want to deploy the metal boxes to the islands because sometimes people break the plastic box. So we want to use the metal boxes in the islands provinces, while in the coastal provinces we'll use plastic boxes.
Sarah Aupong, National MTV News.
On related election news, Commissioner Gamato responded to opposition leader Don Polier's comments on the proposed shortening of the campaign period from 2 months to one, saying it is not his call. He reiterated that the proposed dates are still legal.
The proposed date changes may mean that the issue of writs could be in May and not April, as previously stated. The changes will shorten the campaign period from 2 months to 1 month.
There's already indications that government has expressed through NEC to reduce the campaign period. And they're focusing on the January parliament sitting and a March sitting.
Responding to Don Polier's comments yesterday that criticized this proposal, Commissioner Gamato says it is not his decision.
I'm not a lawmaker. Parliament is a lawmaker, and within the period, within now and the issue of writ, if Parliament decides to change the date, I have no choice, but I have to go by the laws that are made by Parliament. Okay, so that's important. I think the opposition leader must realize that. I'm not a lawmaker. They are the lawmakers, and if Parliament decides to change, I just have to follow them.
However, he says if it does change to May, it would still be legal.
Yeah, the important thing to notice is that it's still within the five-year anniversary. It's not outside, it's within. Yeah, so the government can do that.
According to Commissioner Gamato, NEC's justification to shorten the campaign period is to keep costs down. but for whose benefit is still unclear. During the campaign period, the only people who should be worrying about high cost are the political parties.
Yesterday, opposition leader Don Pollier said the campaign period should remain at 2 months.
Why depriving voters and candidates of this very valuable time of campaign by cutting the campaign period by 1 month? That's a lot of period cut. Why is it cut down to 1 month? The candidates out there would want to campaign and sell themselves as candidates, as leaders to the people for their votes. The voters also need to assess those candidates very well before they cast their votes.
At this stage, Gamato says the dates are tentative until the issue of writs. Sarah Aupong, National MTV News.
Prime Minister Peter O'Neill has come to the defense of the PNG Electoral Commission, calling on opposition leader Don Pollier to respect the PNG EC as a constitutional office and not to drag it into political debate. In a statement late this afternoon, the Prime Minister described the opposition leader's latest comments as highly disrespectful. He called on the opposition leader to respect the fact that the Electoral Commission must remain separate from political debate and be allowed to deliver its mandated job without fear or favor. He said that Pollier should be sensitive to constitutional offices and afford them the respect they deserve. This year's election theme, Your Choice, Protect Our Democracy, spells out clearly that people should consider the election as an important event as it will determine their future and the future of this country. Electoral Commissioner Portilius Gamato says bribery and other unscrupulous behavior which disturbed past elections will be prevented at all cost. He said the Electoral Commission will ensure a fair and safe election this year.
The election slogan, Think, Own and Vote, is important for people to understand its significance.
Basically, that theme encourages everyone, all Papua New Guineans, all citizens of this country, to look at the election as a very important process in electing leaders to parliament, so the leaders can use the parliamentary process to protect our democracy.
He says women and young ladies are mostly affected by other disrespectful voters. This issue will be dealt with a new approach.
Oftentimes we go to polls and we see people pushing and serving each other. I think that's not good. People should respect the process, respect each other, especially respecting women and girls. What I've instructed my officials to do is to try and have two lines. One line for the male and one line for women and girls. So women and girls have their own dedicated line to access polling stations.
Corrupt conduct such as bribery, intimidation and others will be closely monitored and dealt with accordingly.
Even marking of ballot papers under mango trees, that's completely illegal. And so I've given very specific instructions. If any returning officer is seen to be doing that, even after the election, I said I'll refer that official to the police for public corruption. All this nonsense must stop. We have to conduct elections properly.
Gamato says the police have a strategic plan in place to be carried out during the election.
What they've basically told the meeting is that they'll be focusing on using the divisional commanders and provincial police commanders in different provinces. They will have a special unit to respond to situations and circumstances if it arises.
The elections will be observed from the Commonwealth Secretariat and the newly interested group, the European Union.
I'm also looking at inviting the local observers, which will be made up of our top institutions like University, the National Research Institute, TIPNG, Ombudsman Commission, just basically to come and observe. So there is different views from different observer group.
Other countries in the Pacific will also be invited for an independent perspective of the election. Gaile Kivali, National MTV News.
The influx of people into major cities in the country is becoming a norm nationwide. But in this election year, opposition leader Don Polia says these people must return to their home provinces and cast their votes in the coming national elections. Polia called on the Electoral Commission to conduct a diligent electoral roll update prior to voting.
In the past 24 months, urban drift has become common in the major cities of the country. Both LA and Port Moresby are leading the count with people traveling every day between destinations. And with the 2017 national elections looming, opposition leader Don Polia is appealing to people to return to their local communities.
The Highlanders, they have their own electorates to vote their leaders in their electorates. They do not need to come down here to vote for leaders in Port Moresby or in any other city.
Polia says the Electoral Commission has a lot on their hands now to make sure voters remain in their communities while casting votes.
Making sure that those who would like to enroll must have their evidence and some proof to show that they've been living there genuinely for the last minimum of 6 months, as it is required by law to vote.
Meanwhile, Electoral Commissioner Patulius Gamato says most provinces have completed the electoral update, while others have progressed in finalizing their rolls.
We still have time, and the progress so far is good, and I'm pleased, happy with the progress by provinces. In fact, some big provinces are progressing very well. For example, Morobe.
In NCD, all electoral roll updates have been completed for the three electorates and are in the final stages of data processing.
We have committed January for a roll updating exercise, especially data entry. And for the month of February, we want to do roll objection.
The country has about less than 6 months before voters cast their votes in the electorates. Jack Lapave Jr., National MTV News.
East New Britain Provincial Police Commander Senior Inspector Joseph Tabali says he will need at least 147 reservists to provide security during the national elections in the province. This comes after the police headquarters have tasked each regional police command to provide security during the elections using their own available resources. PPC Tabali says East New Britain police have begun working on strategic plans to utilize whatever they have. Edwin Fidelis reports from Kokopo.
In terms of election security, unlike previous years, this year's national election will be different. The divisional commands for each region will be heading the election security exercises without assistance from the PNG police headquarters in Port Moresby. For the police in East New Britain and the New Guinea Islands region, they are already gearing up for the coming big event.
For the duration of
the East New Britain Provincial Police Commander, Senior Inspector Joseph Tabali, says he will invite correctional service and reserve police officers to support his current police strength to participate in the exercises that is expected to drag on for at least 4 months.
I'm expecting 147 reserve police in East New Britain. I'll call them and they will assist in this national election, 2017 national election.
Like any other regions in the country, shortage of manpower and logistical support within the police force in the New Guinea Islands region is a concern. While the police headquarters won't be supporting police operations during the election, each regional command is expected to run the show using their own available resources.
Throughout the entire country, will come up with their own operational order, and they will conduct the general election without the assistance from police headquarters.
The East New Britain Police Board says he will negotiate with the East New Britain Provincial Government to seek support during the election period.
We need to seek assistance from the provincial administration to run this national election next year with the help of Electoral Commission.
National elections are considered a turbulent time, but the head of the East New Britain Police believes his men and women will hold on to their fort until the election ends. Edwin Fidelis, National MTV News, Kokopo.
Today's other stories when we come back, including Morobe's 2017 budget presentation and settling disputes in Irawa district of resource-rich province Southern Highlands. Stay with us. Welcome back. Morobe province is the second province in the country to present its 2017 budget of over 400 million kina to the government. Morobe governor and chairman of the budget committee, Kelly Naru, made the official budget presentation to Treasury Minister Patrick Purach in Port Moresby this morning. The ceremony was witnessed by members of the Morobe Provincial Executive Council. Eric Harupma with this report.
The Morobe 2017 budget, estimated at 424,413,300 kina, mainly comprises of the national grants, 274,027,200 kina, previous year's appropriation, 44,233,100 kina, and the internal revenue, 106,153,600 kina. Speaking during the budget presentation, Morobe Governor Kelly Naru said, "There is a huge carryover under the former year's appropriation from outstanding warrants received without cash from major components of 36.4 million kina DSIP and 5,538,600 kina recurrent budget." He said from this budget, Morobe has utilized huge portion in infrastructure development of core government areas in road construction. Other projects include lay ports and the Najab airport upgrading.
I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the national government through you for the very effective and vibrant partnership and dialogue that we have had in a number of major impact programs and projects that is going on in Morobe province.
Treasury Minister Patrick Pruitt commended Morobe Provincial Government by aligning with the framework the Treasury has set out under the Public Finance Management and following a proper consultation process to come up with a budget.
I congratulate the Governor and the Provincial team for being the second province to present a budget this year. And as we heard from the Governor, the Provincial budget has gone through the normal consultation process and eventually got approved by Tutumang on the 19th of December last year.
However, he said given the economic downturn, the national government will depend heavily on agriculture commodities and Morobe province is no exception. Therefore, the government is focusing on funding projects in Morobe that would serve as a vital link for the country's economic growth. Eric Arupma, National MTV News.
Opposition leader Don Polies says the journalism standard in the country is improving despite challenges. Polies said the work of journalists should not be influenced by those in power, but by proper support through the enhancement of skills development. He called on the government to allow media ownership to be held by the private sector.
How much money has he put into skilling them to supporting this profession at the early stages or at the institutions or on the job training, giving enough funding to the University of Papua New Guinea or giving enough funding to the University of Divine Word in Medang or in other institutions that train journalists? I believe in the quality of journalism in Papua New Guinea. They're doing what they can do at the national level and also at the international level.
The Bulolo Station Commander, Inspector Leo Kaikas, says he is unable to deploy a police contingent to remote Garina to contain ongoing tribal fighting due to lack of funds. Fighting broke out last month between two villages following a lingering dispute, resulting in an unspecified number of deaths and injuries. Some of the injured have been brought in for treatment at the Bulolo District Hospital. Inspector Kaikas has made several requests to the provincial administration to assist. However, delays have continued to the closure of government accounts. Rava District is the home of Lagifu and Gobe oil fields. Oil and gas are the main resources available. 21 indigenous land groups have been called on to forget about disputes and differences and work together to receive royalties and equities for tangible development. This was a concern raised by Kerry Duku, chairman of the Andai Incorporated Land Group from Irava District.
As
Kerry Dugu is appealing to all landowners to collaborate and work together and put submissions to the Land Title Commission for an endorsement for royalties, equities and other outstanding payments that were not paid during the 25 years of prolonged land court battles.
Online in Sembrigi, Bahina in the Gulf Province, Pawala in Sadlan Arabi District, Fiwaga in Sadlo, Kutubu District, those who said duplication beneficiaries benefit from PDL 4 and PDL 3, me appeal once and all. Come, now you miss up, boom one time, say no to Lord Israel DC, now you may go talk maybe like a money, blah, blah.
The Gobi land dispute started in 1989 in a land mediation and then in a local land court from 1990 to 1991. However, the matter wasn't resolved, so it was taken to the district court. From the district court, land inspections was made and the decision was appealed to the national court. While the decision was pending in the national court, the Minister for Petroleum and Energy used his power under the Oil and Gas Act to allocate the landowners with percentage to the 21 ILGs. The percentage wasn't distributed among the landowners equally, leading to a dispute amongst them.
According to the court order, send those four different parties will rule major clan, some major clan, and some Habarbage, and one other clan that been recognized in this Supreme Court. Look, go ahead, now give me submission from legal on. LDC does not. Again, me talk no.
Kerry says they are willing to take the matter to the LTC, but if they do, they will fight a losing battle. Sawato Hahambu, National MTV News.
And now looking at our finance news, the Kina closed unchanged at 0.3150 US dollars in the interbank market. At Bank South Pacific, your Kina was buying 0.3075 US dollars, 0.4152 Australian dollars, 0.2888 euro, and 35.33 Japanese yen. Looking at commodity prices at New York close, gold, coffee, copra, and cocoa all closed the day higher. Palm oil closed lower while crude oil and copper closed higher. And on the stock market, the Dow Jones closed at 31.85 points lower, the ASX is trading at 10.78 points higher, and the All Ordinaries is trading at 10.75 points higher. Stories making headlines overseas when we return, including Barack Obama's farewell speech to the American people. Stay tuned. Welcome back to the news. Turning overseas, U.S. President Barack Obama has ended his presidency with the same message he started with 8 years ago. In an emotional farewell speech, he called for hope and change, urging Americans to protect their democracy. He thanked the country, his daughters, and his wife.
Michelle LaVon Robinson, girl of the South Side. For the past 25 years, you have not only been my wife and mother of my children, you have been my best friend. You made the White House a place that belongs to everybody. And a new generation sets its sights higher because it has you as a role model. So you have made me proud, and you have made the country proud.
President Obama also talked about what is needed to bring America together, and he talked about how it is for Americans to maintain values.
For too many of us, it's become safer to retreat into our own bubbles, whether in our neighborhoods or on college campuses or places of worship or especially our social media feeds. Surrounded by people who look like us and share the same political outlook and never challenge our assumptions. In the rise of naked partisanship and increasing economic and regional stratification, the splintering of our media into a channel for every taste, all this makes this great sorting seem natural, even inevitable. ISIL will try to kill innocent people. But they cannot defeat America unless we betray our Constitution and our principles in the fight. Rivals like Russia or China cannot match our influence around the world unless we give up what we stand for and turn ourselves into just another big country that bullies smaller neighbors.
Prosecutors in the United States say Esteban Santiago confessed to planning the attack at the Florida airport in which he shot dead five people and injured many others. According to court documents, he told authorities that he loaded his gun in the bathroom, then he opened fire at the first people he saw in the baggage claim area.
His troubles began after serving time in Iraq, relatives say. Esteban Santiago spent 10 months in the war-torn country, earning a combat action badge. His brother says the changes in him were apparent.
They had him hospitalized for 4 days, and then they let him go. How are you going to let someone leave a psychological center after 4 days when he is saying that he's hearing voices, that the CIA is telling him to join certain groups?
Santiago's brother, referring to the 26-year-old's meeting with the FBI and a subsequent mental health evaluation. Santiago, on his own, walked into the FBI's Anchorage office last November, seemingly to explain the demons in his head.
Mr. Santiago walked into the Anchorage FBI office to report that his mind was being controlled by a U.S. intelligence agency. During the interview, Mr. Santiago appeared agitated, incoherent, and made disjointed statements.
Authorities say they didn't find his behavior threatening, but there was ample reason to alert the local police, who took him to a psychiatric hospital. In his meeting with the FBI, Santiago said he had a gun, which was seized by the agents.
Santiago was having terroristic thoughts and believed he was being influenced by ISIS. Santiago had a loaded magazine on him, but had left his firearm in his vehicle prior to contacting agents.
CNN has learned the evaluation lasted less than 72 hours. Santiago, a free man. And a month later, he got the gun back from police. The same gun, law enforcement sources say, he used to shoot 11 people at the Fort Lauderdale airport. Santiago's troubled history also includes a domestic violence case involving his girlfriend at this home in Anchorage. In court documents obtained by CNN, Santiago was charged with assault and criminal mischief. He allegedly broke down the bathroom door at his girlfriend's home, and the woman told police that Santiago yelled obscenities while strangling her and smacking her in the side of the head. Santiago pled no contest, but the charges were set to be dismissed if he stayed out of trouble. While a motive for the shooting remains unclear, Santiago's neighbors are left wondering why he chose Fort Lauderdale as his target.
You know, we'd be out in the alley sometime getting firewood. You know, he could have just shot everybody up just in the vicinity if he went down all the way down there to shoot someone.
Despite the FBI's interaction with Santiago, he was not placed on a no-fly list.
There have been concerns raised about why Mr. Santiago was not placed on a no-fly list. I want to be clear. During our initial investigation, we found no ties to terrorism. He broke no laws when he came into our office making disjointed comments about mind control.
So why would someone who is clearly mentally disturbed be able to get his gun back? Well, the U.S. attorney in Alaska says there was no legal basis to prevent him from having it. A judge would have needed to declare him, quote, mentally defective to deny him his Second Amendment rights.
Since the end of the Soviet Union, that nation has had a history of destabilizing breakaway regions in the former Soviet Republic. The result, so-called frozen conflicts. The largest of these conflicts is in eastern Ukraine.
Hot molten metal. For more than a century, workers have been churning out steel at the hulking Ilyich Iron and Steelworks in eastern Ukraine. The former Soviet factory looms over the port city of Mariupol. This company alone employs some 17,000 people.
These colossal steelworks are a critical part of the Ukrainian national economy, and they're located less than a half hour's drive away from the front lines in the war against Russian-backed separatists.
The head of the steelworks tells me the Ukrainian armed forces repelled several previous separatist attempts to capture the factory. It's been more than 2 years since Russian-backed separatists declared two breakaway regions in eastern Ukraine. The subsequent war has displaced around 2 million people and claimed around 10,000 lives. Among the dead, dozens of fighters from Ukraine's Azov regiment, remembered here in a recent torchlight ceremony rife with the regiment's Viking symbolism. Now incorporated under the Ministry of Defense, these Ukrainian nationalists started out as an all-volunteer militia, with members like Stanislav Yermakov.
Before this war, I live in Crimea, and I teach history students in the University of Culture of Crimea.
The former history teacher says he took up arms after Russia's annexation of Crimea from Ukraine in 2014. He says he's defending his country against what he calls the imperialism of Russian President Vladimir Putin.
Putin understand that without Ukraine, without Ukraine territory, they cannot build Russian empire.
Despite a ceasefire, international observers document hundreds of daily violations committed by both sides around the Russian-backed separatist regions. In the former Soviet Union, this is called a frozen conflict.
And this is a copycat situation. There is
former president of Georgia, Mikhail Saakashvili, argues the separatist regions in Ukraine are similar to other Russian-backed breakaway regions in the former Soviet republics of Georgia and Moldova.
Russia decided that it doesn't need borders. Russia decided that it needed basically margins. And it's treating the Soviet, the former Soviet countries as their its margins. And it's basically spreading chaos.
Despite the chaos of the war over the last 2 years, the frontline city of Mariupol today looks rather calm. There's even a new coffee shop in town, opened just 15 kilometers from the front lines. Its young owner may look like any other hipster, but last year, 23-year-old Bogdan Chaban was out fighting for Ukraine after separatists took over his home city of Donetsk. He says the new cafe is a form of unarmed defiance against the enemy that is standing at this city's gates.
Chukai Sports is next. Stay with us for details.
Chukai Sports.
Welcome to Chukai Sports. The PNG senior men's football team will have a busy schedule this year as they prepare to qualify for the FIFA World Cup in Russia 2018. Assistant coach Reginald Davani has put together a 23-man train-on squad that will be in camp in Port Moresby by the end of the month. While in camp, they will focus on preparing for the Oceania's path to qualify for Russia.
The squad includes 16 former and current players, 7 new faces. The 16 former players who are retained are Ismail Pole, Roland Bala, Emmanuel Simon, Jacob Sabua, Otto Kusunan, Raymond Gunemba, Brothers Alwin and Felix Komolong, Philip Steven, Patrick Isa, Ronald Warrison, Leslie Kalai, Daniel Joe, David Muta, Michael Foster and Nigel Debinyaba. The coaching staff also includes 7 new players in the likes of Greg Togubai, Emmanuel Arem, Samuel Kini, Sammy Campbell, David Brown, Stal Gubag and Kolu Kepu. Assistant coach Devani says he is still waiting for the confirmation from 6 more players and also hopes to add to the list 2 to 3 more players who have been identified from abroad. One of those players is from the Australian A-League. With so much at stake, the start of a new pace of qualifying will see Papua New Guinea lining up in Group B against Tahiti and Solomon Islands.
A shot from Tommy Simi
hits the side netting.
PNG kick off their campaign on March 20 and 28 in a home and away match against Tahiti. Shane Saroya, National MTV Sports.
Securing a spot in the FIFA Under-17 World Cup would be the ultimate reward for the hard work PNG Under-17 coach Harrison and his team have put in since November last year. Papua New Guinea enters their seventh OFC Under-17 Championship with a qualification for the FIFA Under-17 World Cup in India in October this year.
Guided by coach Harrison Kamake, the squad began training for the OFC Under-17 Men's Championship late last year with the goal to reach the final. Kamake says the team comprises of a blend of youth with experience, and he believes his players can win the tournament if they approach each and every game according to the way they planned. The team travels to New Zealand on the 19th and will have a few lead-up matches against New Zealand Under-17 national side, as well as the Fiji Under-17 national team. They will spend 2 weeks in New Zealand with the trial matches, giving helpful tips for coach Kamake to see where their strengths are as a team. PNG share Group A with New Caledonia, Tahiti and Vanuatu, who are all strong contenders in the race to India 2017, whilst tournament favourites New Zealand's in Group B with Fiji, Samoa and Solomon Islands. Papua New Guinea plays the first game against New Caledonia on 11th February, and coach Kamake knows the importance of winning the first game to start the competition. Shane Saroya, National MTV Sports.
Pacific Games gold medalist of the 4x100 meters relay Wesley Logorava and decathlon gold medalist Robson Yinambe left for the United States this afternoon. The two will be undergoing intensive athletics training while attending a community college in Kansas. Logorava and Yinambe were part of a small group that has been training in Lae for the past 12 months with the assistance of Athletics PNG. This is one strategy that is currently being implemented by APNG to better athletes, as there were other athletes who have gone overseas for such programs. Chukai Sports continues after the break. Stay with us.
Chukai Sports.
Welcome back to Chukai Sports. The PIH Indoor Cricket Competition is looking forward to its Round 9 events this weekend, with a few double-header events to be played. As of this weekend, all competitions are scheduled to start at 10 a.m. until the final playoffs between the top four teams.
With PIH Indoor Cricket Competition approaching Round 9 of Season 5, the event will see some double-header playoffs for all teams starting this weekend and will continue up until the finals. In line with this, game schedules will also change, where competition for both days will start at 10 a.m. each week. With five rounds yet to be played for both men's and mixed teams, top four teams from each pool will advance to Super 8s, while team ranked from 5th to the 10th spot will advance into the plate playoffs, whilst teams ranked outside of 10 will miss out on the playoffs. Playoffs at this stage will commence on the 11th of February. While initial draws were scheduled to be played until round 11, Pom Cricket Association decided to extend a round due to not having enough time for each teams to play against each other, deferring their rounds to 13 and ensuring all teams are included. Moving forward, any washout events that occur in the next few rounds will not be replayed due to lack of time and accessibility of courts, with all washout matches to result in no points. Meanwhile, Round 9 mixed match between NTIL and Brian Bell has been moved forward to next weekend. Godwin Eki, National MTV Sports.
The PNG Rugby Sevens women's team, the Palais, are well on their way to a good 2017 campaign. Coach John Larry said his side is aiming to be the first team to qualify for the HSBC World Sevens Series.
With the Palais training well underway, Coach Larry said the team has been in camp for the last few weeks and among them three debutants as well. The 18 women team itself is an exceptional new lot, all of whom will be taking part in the first leg of the HSBC World 7 Series, which will be on April 7th to the 9th.
We missed out last time on the World Circuit and we're going back again. This time we don't want to have this memories from before. We want to get there and we've been working hard for a very long time.
PNGRFU interim president Stephen Kamis said their ultimate goal for this year's campaign is to be a worthy and threatening opponent. Being a dominant team in the region, the Palais have a shot at the Sevens World Cup debut, given that Oceania has two qualifying spots. The only threat to PNG is Samoa.
Whipping out wide, and she goes over for the first try of this match.
The team will be leaving next Thursday for Brisbane, where they will finalize their training before taking Sydney early February. All are part of the build-up towards their Hong Kong appearance.
Tournaments like Wellington and also Sydney, they're really just training, where they're not important. They're only important in the sense of preparation for Hong Kong, because Hong Kong is where we get the chance to qualify both men and women's for the World Rugby Sevens Circuit. Okay, so this is going to be the first attempt that we will have under my regime. So we're going to try and give it as good a go as we can.
Meanwhile, there are already plans in place to send both the men's and women's teams to Fiji for tougher training after the 2017 campaign. Dini Rose Raiko, National EMTV Sports.
Pangea Station 2 will get a facelift of its rugby league facility after their off-season competition impressed local government authorities on how much interest was shown by youths. Yalibu Town Mayor Jacob Iggy called for government support in sporting activities to help keep the livelihoods of the youth in tune and to keep them occupied and away from illegal activities.
Youths in the remote Pangea district of Southern Highlands captivated government representatives during their off-season rugby league grand final competition last Saturday. The William Powey Cup finals brought youths together from all four corners of the district to participate in the off-season tournament. The field that was used to play the William Powey Cup is the only field that's utilized every year for sporting events, particularly rugby league. With talks to upgrade the facility, it is understood that maintenance to the field will change the mindsets of the youths, who can look forward to representing their wards and fully understand the opportunities that sports can bring to one's life. The new change will see the planting of new posts and well-maintained field that youths in the district can use for sporting and community events. President of East Pangea LLG, Daniel Pioko, encouraged the Pangea youths to continue to embrace sports, particularly rugby league, and live better lives away from drugs and alcohol abuse, which only causes more social problems. Yalibu Town Mayor Jacob Iggy, who represented Mr. Powey, said the Southern Highlands governor has already committed 200,000 kina to Pangea Rugby League for 2017, which can be used to upgrade the oval. Pangea Station 2 councillor Pimi Taita agreed, saying Pangea Rugby League has supplied some notable players to Digicel Cup teams over the years, and such an upgrade of playing facilities will only improve the standard of the game. Powey Cup chairman Jack Kipoi thanked Governor Powey for his support and called for more assistance in 2017 to upgrade the oval by leveling the surface, building permanent goalposts. Godwin Eki, National MTV Sports.
And that's a wrap for True Kai Sports. We'll be back with the weather details after the break. True Kai Sports.
True Kai Sports.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
Your weather forecast for tonight and tomorrow: cloudy showers in Port Moresby and Alotau, also Papendeta, and cloudy in Daru and Kerama. In the Momase region, cloudy period with showers in Lae, Medang, Wewak and Vanimore. In the New Guinea Islands region, cloudy in Loringau, Kavieng, Kokopo and Rabaul, cloudy periods with showers in Kimbe and Buka. And in the Highlands region, cloudy in Mount Hagen, Mandi and Wabeg, and rain showers in Goroka and Kundiawa.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
And before we go, more details of the alleged hijacking attempt on Singapore-bound Air New Guinea flight on Monday will be made clear in a news conference scheduled for early tomorrow morning. A passenger who was on the same outbound flight will be speaking to media about the incident. EMTV News will be covering the media conference and we'll have more on this story in tomorrow night's bulletin. And that's been the news, sports and weather for tonight. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Helen Sayre. Pleasant viewing. Good night.